What would Jesus do? In order to talk about that, we're going to go to a story in the book of Luke. And in the book of Luke, it talks in chapter 7 concerning an encounter that Jesus had and how he reacted to the situation. You know, every once in a while in our lives, we have things that come up that we are not prepared for it or whatever, and then we're kind of caught off guard and we have to try to react. And one of the things that happens is that we spend some of our time trying to reevaluate, you know, well, I wish I'd said it differently, I wish I'd done that differently if I'd only known. But we're human and we don't always get it right. But in the story here, we're going to see how this plays out concerning Jesus. One of the Pharisees, now the Pharisees were a religious sect in Judaism, and there were different groups that practiced a certain type of Judaism. And you have the Pharisees as one group. They went back to their originator, a priest by the name of Ezra, in the book, in the Old Testament. His book is in there. And this was a very strict sect. And they were very zealous for what they believed the law had said concerning how we should live and how we should react to people, those of the faith and those who are not of the faith. And they had some very strong lines of demarcation. And one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to have dinner with him. So Jesus went to his home and sat down to eat. When a certain immoral, the word there indicates a prostitute, when a certain immoral woman from that city heard he was eating there, she brought a beautiful alabaster jar filled with expensive perfume. Then she knelt behind him at his feet weeping. Her tears fell on his feet and she wiped them off with her hair. Then she kept kissing his feet and putting perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of a woman is touching him. She is a sinner." Then Jesus answered his thoughts. "Simon," he said to the Pharisee, "I have something to say to you." "Go ahead, teacher," Simon replied. Then Jesus told him this story. A man loaned money to two people, 500 pieces of silver to one and 50 pieces to the other. But neither of them could repay him, so he kindly forgave them both, canceling their debts. Who do you suppose loved him more after that? Simon answered, "I suppose the one to whom he canceled the larger debt." "That's right," Jesus said. And he turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Look at this woman kneeling here. When I entered your home, you didn't offer me water to wash the dust from my feet, but she has washed them with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You didn't greet me with a kiss, but from the time I first came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You neglected the courtesy of olive oil to anoint my head, but she has anointed my feet with rare perfume. I tell you, her sins, and they are many, have been forgiven. So she has shown me much love. But a person who is forgiven little shows only a little love." Then Jesus said to the woman, "Your sins are forgiven." The men at the table said among themselves, "Who is this man that he goes around forgiving sins?" And Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." What a tremendous story it is when you read those few verses of Scripture, because they denote what it means to have mercy, to receive and to give mercy. And when we read this story, we find some things out that are applicable to our own day-to-day living. Our conduct, our actions, our attitude, our outlook, and even our worldview. And so we're going to take a journey into that time frame, that time setting. In the days of Jesus, in that time, they didn't sit at a table like we do. We sat and go to a booth at a restaurant afterwards, and our table there, and we sat at a 90-degree angle, and we eat with the food in front of us. In those days, they reclined with the head facing the table, and they would just reach up, and they would talk back and forth and converse and take the food. So it's a different type of scenario, different time, a different part of the world. And so we are going to enter into that world to the best of our ability, considering our world and our culture. But the Bible is relevant in the fact that the stories that are there may be from a time past, but the message, the moral truth, is always relevant to the life of the one who follows Jesus Christ. Because humans don't change from generation to generation. Whether you ride a donkey or you drive a Porsche. If you do drive a Porsche, congratulations. But whichever way, you still have to travel to get there. Most people in those days walked. Today, we do other ways to get there most of the time. So the first one on your fill in the blank is just simply the word questions. Just questions. A simple word, questions. We're going to ask our series a few questions from this text tonight, today. The first question is, who was this woman? Who was this woman? Well, oftentimes people mistakenly thought that she was Mary Magdalene or Mary Bethany, which are recorded in Matthew, the 26th chapter, Mark, the 14th chapter, and John, the 12th chapter. She is not either one of those women. This is a totally different story. And when you go and you read the other stories, you'll find that there is a difference in the characters who are there. And so she was not that woman. But what do we know about her? First of all, we see the dark sin stained of her soul. What dark sin stained her soul? What was it that caused her to have such a stain of sin in her life? Secondly, the question is, where did she find the courage to endure the scorn of the religious elite? Where did that come from? You see, when we read this, we just get a glimpse. And when you look at the Greek word, the word for sin there, it says basically that this also can refer to an immoral woman. So we don't know what immorality was, if it was a sexual immorality or one of the things, because you see, morality is not, when we say immoral, maybe we think about some kind of a sexual misconduct. But immorality can be anything. A person who lies, breaks the trust, that's an immoral act. A person who hates in the place of love commits an immoral act. A person who steals, even, can commit an immoral act. There are various things that violate God's law, the moral law of God, the spiritual law of God. And the Bible says, in that category, guess what? We all belong, for all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, there's no greater ones and lesser ones in the eyes of God. There are two classifications of people, according to Scripture, the saints and the ain'ts. And if you're an ain't, you can become a saint. And if you become a saint, you don't want to go back and become an ain't. You want to stay with Jesus. Because that is the promise that God gives to us. We don't know what caused her to go down the road that she went down. We don't know what situations in her life were so traumatic that caused her to turn to a lifestyle that basically excommunicated her from the society which she was a part of. We actually don't know where the courage came from, except that God has a prevenient grace. And he began to work in her before she met Jesus. You see, God works in your life before you come to know Christ to prepare your heart to receive Christ. And it's a sense of understanding that the courage came because she had a desire, and the desire superseded the fear. Because when you come to Christ, naturally there's some apprehension. What does that mean? Does that mean that I'm going to have to sell everything and go to a foreign country to become a missionary? Well, let's put it this way. If God calls you to be a missionary in a foreign country, you don't want to stay here. You want to go there because your heart won't be here and be there. But most of the time, what happens in our lives is that when we come to know Jesus Christ, God just changes us in our environment. He doesn't go across the country or around the world. Most of the time, he says, go back and tell those who know what great things the Lord has done for you. That's what he did throughout the Bible. He said, go back and tell those you know what's happened. And so we see this. The second question that comes to mind is WWJD again, but only it would be this. What would Jesus do in this instance? Would Jesus be embarrassed by her presence being there? Would he feel uncomfortable? Would he choose to ignore her as if she was not there? Would he openly reject her, repudiate her? Would he dismiss her and send her away? I haven't got time for you. Those are the questions that the woman who came must have thought within her mind. When I come, what will he do in response to my coming? You see, in the biblical times, the rabbis of that time never talked with women in a public. And if they could help it, if they would not talk to them. And if they had to contact them and speak to them, the conduct was always exceptional. No the boundary lines were distinct. And here was a rabbi, a teacher. Would he follow the same plan? Did she dare hope that this friend of publicans and sinners would read her heart and defend her against her accusers and detractors? What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? She took the chance. You see, the setting of the story, number two, the setting makes the story. We see some things here. We see that this attitude of the Pharisee, said to Jesus, "Come and let's eat together." But was his motive pure? Was he being a congenial guest and host? Come and eat, but were his motives pure? You see, we now know that Simon had a very dark agenda. Oftentimes, we find that throughout the Gospels that there were those who were constantly trying to get Jesus into a spot where they could find an accusation against him. And Simon's dark agenda is seen not in what he says and how he acts, but by what he thinks. You see, the Bible says that humanity looks at our outward appearance, but God knows what's in our heart. He understands what comes out of our heart, either good or evil. And we can keep our opinions to ourselves, and that's fine. Matter of fact, it's better to do that. But oftentimes, we have to guard even our opinions because they may be based upon a predisposed prejudice towards something that would cause us to look and not know the full story of the person that we are talking to or about their journey. We look at this, we find his dark agenda. First of all, he judges the woman. He saw her. He was appalled that she would even come into his house. Protocol said you had to be polite. But don't you know that he was steaming as he saw her come in? How could she defile his home? She had walked right past the mezuzah where the law was. She was a violator of the law. How could she be there in his presence? He judged this woman. Now that's bad enough. But it's even worse to judge the Christ. For you hear his thoughts as they echo through the centuries. That which is kept in his mind in the silence of his thoughts now are heralded out through the generations as he said this, "If this man was a prophet." Do you notice the disdain of that thought process? If he was a prophet, he knew that his desire was to discredit him and to remove any sense of legitimacy from Jesus. If he knew this woman, if this man really is a prophet, the second thing, he would know what type of woman she is. I'm glad that when I read the scripture, that I can move past those who in their religious beliefs feel that they are superior to others to the humility of a Christ who looks and says, "Yes, you're broken, but I can fix it. Yes, you're sick, but I can heal you. Yes, you're wounded, but I can comfort you. Yes, you're rejected, but I will accept you." What would Jesus do? We look at this. We see her penitent heart. We see her outward devotion, but we also see her outward preparation. "I will take the chance if he'll just smile with me and a favored glance." The third thing, or the second thing is, the third thing rather, WDJD. WGJD. What did Jesus do? It's not just enough, what would Jesus do? The question is, from the Bible, what did Jesus do? Let's look at his response. He saw in her heart contrition. Her humble spirit versus Simon's religious pride. Christ then says to Simon, who knew his thoughts when Simon thought nobody knew his thoughts, "I have have a story I want to tell you, Simon. Well, what's the story? There were these two guys. Let's put it in our language. This guy, he got a loan from this guy. The guy gave him $500 to help him. Another guy was kind of tight. He looked at him and says, you know what? Would $50 help you? I'll pay you back. Both of them said they would. But time came and they couldn't do it. And they came to him and they said this. You know, I'm sorry, but I just can't pay back the $500. Things didn't even get worse. The other guy said, same here. Now, the guy who was owed the money could have looked at him and says, you're failures, or you're liars, or you're cheats. But instead he says, I understand. And you know what? Keep the money. You don't have to pay me back a thing. I just give it to you as a gift. And then he said to Simon, Simon said, which one do you think would show more love and really be more in debt to him? He said, and Simon, you can see Simon's wheels turning in mind. Simon's thinking, now wait a minute here. I've got to be very careful how I answer this because I can see where this is going. So he used, which I don't gamble, but usually a gambling bet, he hedged his bets. He said, well, I suppose probably most likely the one who owed him the most would have the most gratitude. And Simon's heart was exposed in that moment. Jesus looked at him and said this, you know, Simon, when I came to your house to eat, that was kind of you to invite me to eat. But you let me know by your actions you really didn't want me here for any kind of a congenial purpose. See, in the Middle East, the custom was because most people walked. Only the rich had something to ride in or ride on. So they walked down these dusty roads. They'd have those sandals on, and the dust would be there. The heat would be coming down on their sandals, their feet, and all. When they come to a place, the servants would come, and they would wash the feet to cool the feet. And then they would do certain things also to help with this. They would greet them to let them know you're welcome with what we call a social kiss. It was a kiss on both cheeks. They still do that a lot in the Middle East. You'll see it sometimes when they meet one another. It's more like, almost like a Hollywood kiss. But it's a sense of saying you're welcome in my home. This is how I open my heart to you in action, doing that. And then he looked at him and says, and you put no oil on my head. They would try to just soothe, if their scalp got burned or whatever. He said, but from the time I came here, this is what she's done. She's washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. She has taken perfume and perfumed my feet. She did for me what you wouldn't do for me. You see, it's a strange thing, but Proverbs 23:6-7 kind of gives us an insight into the character of some people. So don't eat with people who are stingy. Don't desire the delicacies. They are always thinking about how much it costs. Eat and drink, they say, but they don't mean it. And you got one or two choices when you go to a place like that. You can eat very sparingly and say, I'm not really all that hungry, and you better not be lying about that. That you're saying, I just want it. Or you can go the other way. Say, this guy ain't going to ever ask me back again. I'm going to eat him out of house and home. But it simply says that they're always counting. They're always calculating. Simon was calculating through this story. How can I get to Jesus? And how can I make him look foolish before others? You see, this sect began with the prophet, the priest named Ezra. And it's in the book of Ezra in the Old Testament. A man who was led by the Spirit of God, fasted and prayed to bring back the artifacts to restore and rebuild the temple in Jerusalem after being destroyed by the Chaldean armies. And how that he prayed for God to bring revival to his land. But sometimes things that start out good can always kind of take a strange turn. And that's what happened by the time of Jesus. These people were very concerned about being correct in every way. Even to the point that if they achieved it, they wanted to condemn those who didn't achieve it. And bottom line is, you just can't achieve it. Because there are 613 laws under the Mosaic Law. And sometimes to do one, you break another. Yet they were very zealous of what they did. And what happened as a revival movement, it turned into a legalistic, judgmental movement. And you see, when you start, let me remind you this, your strength can become your weakness. And your weakness can become your strength. Let me say that again. Your strength can become your weakness, and your weakness can become your strength. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, let me tell you. There's a good example. That is Samson in the Bible. A child who was dedicated to the Lord in advance of his birth. He let his hair grow because he was a sect of the Nazarite. And God said, this is a sign of a covenant between me and him. I'm going to use him to set my people free. And Samson was a mighty warrior. He did great exploits for God. But he began to find his sense of trust in his ability and not God's availability. And so he got mixed up with a woman named Delilah, and she talked to him to tell him how he was strong, and he said, this covenant was between me and God and the hair. It says, if my hair gets cut, I become weak. So when he slept, the Bible says that she called a barber, and they cut his hair, and then she said, Samson, the Philistines are after you. And this is what is so tragic in that scripture. He says, I will do as before and shake myself free. But he didn't realize the Lord had left him in Judges 16, too. He was so used to things being that way that he let his strength become his weakness, and his weakness became his strength. What he had, he lost. And what he got in return was not worth it. And this is what happens oftentimes if we're not careful, is that we can become religious and we can go cold in our relational experience with God. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Your spiritual man hungers to be with God in eternity, but he hungers to be with God now. Your spiritual person, man or woman. So we look at this, we see this in her life. The first thing we see of her is conversion. Paul, who was a great Pharisee before he found Christ, in 2 Corinthians 12, 9 through 10, speaks about himself. He says this, each time he said to me, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. I love this last phrase, for when I am weak, then I am strong. If you stand in your own power, you can only stand so long. But if you stand in God's power, you can stand firm in a hurricane. That is the power of God. So the first thing is she came because she knew she needed Jesus, and that's how we come to Christ. It's when we say, you know what? I may be a good person, but there's something lacking in my life. I really need to know God and to know his love. I'm satisfied in so many ways in my life, but there's something there. Because it's a sense of understanding that Pascal said that there is in each one of us a God void that cannot be filled with the presence of God. I don't care what else you try to fill it with, it will not work. It is a sense of understanding that you're a spiritual person. You're a human, you're intellectual, you're mental, but you're also spiritual. And oftentimes we try to suppress the spiritual, especially in our world today, in which we are very logical, very scientific. And it is since that we have tried to denigrate or even marginalize the idea of the spiritual us to the point that we simply discredit it or deny its existence. But guess what? It is like taking a volleyball and pushing it and dropping it into a pool and pushing it to the bottom. The more deeper it goes, the more resistance you get, and it's going to bounce back up no matter how strong you are. Whenever the pressure is there, you're not stronger than that volleyball. And that's the same way it is in your spiritual condition. No matter what you do to try to satisfy yourself, to try to placate your feelings of emotions and the needs in your life, you're never going to find it complete until you find the answer for completeness, and that's in Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus. He's the one who releases you from the bondage of your guilt, of your pain, and of your suffering. He's the one who mends your broken heart, spiritually speaking. And the one who gives you hope that what you were in the past doesn't mean that's what you're going to be from this point on. And so we find her change because she knew where her help came from. It came from Christ. The second thing was, along with that came consecration or devotion. Now, when we talk about consecration, devotion, you know, some people think, well, it's a bunch of rules and regulations, and if I do this and I'm consecrated, you know, it's good to be obedient to the Word of God. But consecration is a desire of love to do what God wants you to do, not because you're afraid of hell, because you just love God and you want to be with him forever. That's the reason why the Bible says that his commandments are not a burden to us, because of the joy that we get of knowing we are loved and being able to love back. And so in this story, it tells us about this. In James 4 and 6 says it this way, "But he gives us even more grace to stand against such evil desires. As the scripture says, God opposes the proud but favors the humble." The greatest enemy of our lives is pride. That will be your downfall. If anything will cause you to collapse, it's pride. Because, you know, sometimes we are trained, we're skilled, we're educated. And if we're not careful, we can begin to look at some of those who maybe have not got the formal training or skill. Or maybe we have a talent and they don't have that talent. You know, some people sing beautifully. And some people sing beautifully too, but it's not in the voice of man that is pleasant, but it's the Spirit. They make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Do you see in our lives? Well, the danger is that we can think that we have got all the answers, we've got it all together. But I want to tell you, the older that I am, the more that I study, the more I realize just how inexperienced I am and how much more I need to learn. Because the ability of any person, no matter if they are a genius, is still wholly lacking when compared to the knowledge and the majesty of God. And so we look at this, we find that her in her act of conversion, that she showed that she was consecrated. Her devotion to God was one of love. She wept when she saw him because she knew that if she was ever going to be different, it was through him. And when he said, "Your sins are forgiven," you know what? In every other time in the Bible, many places you look, you say, "Go and sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." A warning to her. She has loved much. Your sins are forgiven. He didn't have to say, "Go and sin no more." He knew she wasn't going to go back. You see, that's the marvelous saying about this story, is that from that moment she entered in a sinner and she left a saint. There was a coronation that took place that day. She came in rags and she left wearing the robe of a king's child. That's what happens when you come to Jesus Christ. Jesus sees you where you're at. And he sees you where you will be when you let him lead you. You see, God's promises are true. Let me tell you a story. I mentioned it before, but I want to bring it back to memory here. I want to talk to you about a woman named Bulldog. Bulldog. What a name. That was her. That was the label the town where my family originated from put on her. A little town in southern Illinois was a coal mining town and an oil town. It was a booming time, and people came in from all over. It became a ruckus place in that little hamlet. It's not that way anymore because the boom left, and they all left too. And so it was that during that time, people came from all over. There was a town prostitute that they called Bulldog. The reason why they called Bulldog, she walked down the street. She would take anybody on. She had always wore a red dress, a red hat, and a big red feather, and she, that's why they called her Bulldog, because she had two bulldogs that walked in front of her. And she did not care what anybody thought about her morals. She could care less. She was one tough woman. And in that town, one day came a traveling minister who had a tent, and he set it up on the outskirts of town in a wooden grove. And he had an old wooden platform that he stood on to speak. And he began holding revival services there at that town. In our hometown, my great-grandparents went to see what was going on, because this was something unique going on. A preacher coming in, setting up a tent, doing this. We didn't know what this was about. So they went down there, and lo and behold, the Lord saved them. Now, they were religious people, but they had never really accepted Jesus. And God saved them and transformed their life. They were leaders in the community. Business people, professional people. God saved them. Others started coming. The people came from all over that area. A great revival broke out. A great religious meeting took place. And the preacher was preaching every night. And every night people were coming to accept Jesus as their Savior. like you've seen in pictures of a Billy Graham crusade. Bulldog heard about it, so she went, but she knew she wouldn't be welcome in there because the women of the town didn't like her. The men didn't want to be around her because some of them had already been there. But she stood out in the dark, in the woods, behind the trees, and she listened night after night to this man's message about God loving and God forgiving. Finally, one night in the midst of his message, T.B. Barnett got off the stage and walked down the aisle between the rough benches. And he went out underneath the trees, and a few minutes later, he came walking back. And right behind him, crying, came Bulldog. And she knelt at an altar and asked Jesus to come into her heart. And when she prayed, God heard, and she was gloriously saved. Decades later, she died. Do you know at her funeral? God sent a man into her life who loved her regardless of her past. They married, they had kids, grandkids, great-grandkids. Do you know that at that funeral were several of her children who were ministers? Nobody remembered Bulldog, but they did remember Sister Dempsey. For you see, that's what Jesus does. What Jesus did for the woman in this scripture, what Jesus did for Bulldog, he will do for you. And how do I know that? Because he did it for me. He did it for me. WWJD, what will Jesus do for you? Let's pray.